Good morning, guys. In yesterday's class, we have seen key advantages of IP and also two types of IP models we have studied, that is IP adoption and IP adaptation. And we have also seen which model we have to select and what are the factors we have to consider to select these models, whether adoption or adaptation. Okay. So these all things we have studied. Today let us go to the next topic, that is the need of optimization or need for a optimization. Why we need to optimize the IoT network and the devices which are present in the IoT network, and the main optimization focus is here is on IP. It means why we have to optimize the IP. Okay. So as previously already what we discussed is IoT is completely built on IP. It means IoT is completely dependent on IP. Okay, so IP is a network layer protocol. Okay, so since complete the era of IoT is dependent on IP, but still IP has some drawbacks or some limitations or some disadvantages or some challenges. Okay, if you consider, the first challenge is dealing with non-IP devices. For example, yesterday I have given one example, that is you have to adjust with your roommate. So if you are a Karnataka student and if your roommate is a Maharashtra student, then there is a communication gap between you and him or her, and still you have to adjust with your roommate, right? That is nothing but adaptation. So in addition to this adjustment, still there are so many challenges are there, difficulties are there. So these difficulties can be overcome, and if those difficulties or challenges are there, still that Internet of Things, that is IoT, is dependent upon this IP. It means IoT is using largely this IP. Okay, so here the first challenge already I told you, that is dealing with or adjusting with this non-IP devices. Because in IoT, not only we are connecting the things which are having IP addresses, so we are connecting the things which are not having IP addresses also, we are connecting there. So for example, non-IP devices are maybe a setup box of our television, cable cards, so many other non-IP devices are also maybe present there. Okay, so here it means that if it is a IoT network, there are both IP devices are there and non-IP devices are also present there. Okay, so we are going to deal with this type of non-IP and IP devices. Okay, and we are also going to deal with some limitations or drawbacks of devices and limitations of networks. So like this, in each and every layer of our IP stack, we are going to observe some limitations and drawbacks or some disadvantages or some restrictions. Okay, so because of these restrictions, we have to make optimization in each and every layer. Okay, so don't optimize the entire network at a whole. So for layer by layer, in every layer, in each and every level wise, we have to optimize. Okay, so you know, we use usually for IP protocols or any protocol stacks, we usually use layered architecture, right? In every layer, we have to do this optimization so that we can overcome these limitations. Okay, so then here, nodes and network itself can be constrained. So in previous module, you studied one small topic there, that is constrained nodes or constrained devices. And also you studied constrained network. What do you mean by this constrained nodes and constrained network? Constraint is nothing but constraints. Constraints are nothing but restrictions, limitations. Okay, so the nodes which are having some limitations, they have less capacity. So that devices are constrained devices. And particularly if you want a technical definition, that also I told you there, these are the end devices which are dealing with or coping with a particular or specific application. What is that specific application? It requires less power consumption, it requires less data, it requires less bandwidth. Like this, some limitations are there, some constraints are there, some conditions or restrictions are there. Such type of nodes are called as constrained nodes. And the networks which have such type of limitations, these are called as constrained networks. So remember these two words, constrained nodes and constrained networks. It means that we can put conditions on restrictions on these nodes, and those nodes will become constrained nodes, and the networks with this type of conditions, limitations, constraints, restrictions, these are called as constrained networks. Okay, so here, sir, why we will get to such type of difficulties or drawbacks or conditions or restrictions here, limitations? Because every day by day nowadays, the technologies keep on evolving and it is keep on advancing, right? So because of these extra facilities, features, if you want to access, then definitely we have to face some limitations. So we have to observe those limitations and we try to eliminate or overcome these limitations. So for example, you know, earlier days we used IPv4, that is a version 4 of IP protocol. Even nowadays also we will use this, right? But now slowly we are transitioning from IPv4 to IPv6. It means we are trying to use IPv6 now onwards. In fact, now completely we are not using IPv6. Still IPv4 is also there, but some devices are addressed with the IP address which are formed by this IPv6. Okay, it means that presently we are using both IPv4 as well as IPv6 right now. Okay, earlier there were only IPv4 devices. Okay, so this type of advancements, this type of transitions, this type of transformations from IPv4 to IPv6. So if you want to use IPv6, definitely there will be some restrictions or limitations. Okay, so it may be having some limitations because of such type of transitionings or some advancements or some changes in our networking system. So we have to deal with such type of constrained nodes, constrained networks. Okay, so let us see first constrained nodes here. If you remember in module 2, there was a table number 4. There I shown you three classes of devices. The devices are categorized as class 0, class 1, and class 2. Okay, so here class 1, there I told you in class 1 we cannot implement a full stack IP. In class 2 we can use a full stack of IP. Such type of differences I told you. So these devices, whatever we are using in IoT, they are classified as class 0, class 1, and class 2. Okay, so here, depending upon these functions, depending upon these functions in a network, that function of a thing, because in network things are there, right? We are connecting the things in IoT. So we have to consider the architecture of that thing. It means architecture of that device, and we have to think about the function of that device. So what it does exactly. Okay, so by considering this function, depending upon this function, that architecture sometimes it may or it may not give us some characteristics. So characteristics of that thing or device which are similar to our generic personal computer. It means that our personal computer, whatever the task it is doing, same type of characteristics or features we may get or we may not get. So when we consider a thing in IoT network, okay. And here, another limitation is what it is. It is a network protocol stack. Network protocol stack. This network protocol stack here. Any IoT node, if you consider any IoT device, if you consider that device will be communicating with another device through one unreliable path. Unreliable path. This is also one disadvantage, one limitation. It is a limitation of a device. Okay, so one device in the IoT network is communicating with another device on or through unreliable path. What do you mean by unreliable path? It means that there is no any guarantee that this path will be always 24 into 7, always it will be operable or operational or properly working. It means that maybe that path may be disconnected, and that communication may be also destroyed, and data loss may happen. Okay, so communication may not be a success communication. Okay, so these nodes in our IoT network, may be communicating through such type of paths which are called as unreliable path. Okay, so this is also one limitation which is related to constrained nodes. Then even though there is a full IP stack is there for our particular device or particular node, still some limitations are there. I already told you that the limitation is nothing but, so we may get some unexpected throughput. Actually, you are using full IP stack, you are implementing full IP stack to your device, but your device is providing you some unexpected throughput. You are expecting a more or high throughput, but it is giving you less throughput. Okay, and one more limitation is with a low convergence. Okay, so this type of convergence is nothing but combining or togetherness. So these all are some networking terms. Okay, so even though we use a full IP stack, there are some limitations are there. There are some unexpected outputs are there, like a throughput and low convergence like this. And one more very important characteristic or aspect what we have to consider is our power consumption, because some devices consume less power and some devices consume more power. Okay, so this is a very important aspect whenever we discuss about the constraints of nodes or limitations of node or restrictions of our nodes. Okay, so here some devices may be expecting only some few months of battery life, and some devices may be expecting a long battery life. For example, some devices may be having a battery life of only some 6 months or 10 months or 12 months, but some devices may be expecting the battery life about 10 years or 20 years also. Okay, so here some network technologies are there, networking technologies like high speed technologies, we call them high speed technologies, like cellular networking technologies, Wi-Fi technology, Ethernet technology. So this type of technologies, whenever we select these technologies which are high speed technologies, these are till today they are not having a capacity to have long battery life. They have only 6 months or 10 months or 12 months of battery life. Okay, so they are not capable of having a multi-year battery life. So such kind of devices are there. So based on that, you can select the technologies. Okay, so here the present capability or current capability, practically it allows us less than a year. Usually right now, practically what type of battery life we have a battery life which is less than a year. It means it may be 6 months or 4 months or 10 months. Okay, so very less battery life we have right now in these technologies. And some applications are there, some technologies are there, some devices are there, they don't use much power, they use less or low power, that is their power consumption is very very less. Okay, so such type of technologies, they never ever want the batteries at all. Then sir, what will be the source of power for them? The source of power for such type of nodes will be either solar or else direct your power, that is your connecting to your power source. So they do not require a battery as a source of power, because they consume a very less amount of power. So because of that only, seeing these all things, so what you understood is whenever there is a high power consumption devices are there, most probably these high power consumption nodes will be operated mainly on batteries. The devices which are consuming less power, they don't want these batteries. They can survive with the solar or any other power source. Okay, so these power consumption requirements on battery powered nodes will definitely communicate, they will affect our communication. Okay, so whenever we communicate, we allow the two devices to communicate, so usually there will be some options to manage these power. Okay, so for example, there is an option like a low power mode, and there is an option like always on. Okay, so you can enable low power it. Then onwards, that device starts to consume less power. Okay, unnecessarily it will not consume your battery. And we should avoid such type of options. That is, we should disable always on option. It means always on means what? It is anytime, whenever your device is not in use also, it will consume more amount of power. So we should disable such type of options, and we should also use the options like always off. It means whenever you want to use the device, at that time only you can make it as low power or always on, and after the using of that device, you can again enable this option, that is always off. Okay, so unnecessarily we should not use the or consume the power of a battery or battery power. Okay, then this classification of or categories of these constraint nodes. So by dividing these constraint nodes as a class 0, class 1, class 2, what I already categorized in the previous module in table number 4. So by doing this, what happens? We can easily evaluate, we can easily test the IP adoption and IP adaptation model selection. It means that so by doing this classification also, we can select, or it will be help, it will be easy for us to select either IP adoption model or else IP adaptation model. Yesterday I told you already when we should use adoption and when we should use adaptation. So if there is a adjustment, then definitely it is a adaptation. If there are some restrictions are there, some limitations are there, some drawbacks are there, some conditions are there, constraints are there, so definitely you use IP adaptation model instead of ID adoption. If everything is beautiful, everything is perfect, then you should use IP adoption. Okay, so then these constraint nodes can be classified as a class 0, class 1, class 2. Already we have seen, right? So in detail, if you classify them, how we can classify them? See, the devices are classified into again three categories here. The first type of category of devices, this type of devices are very constrained in the resources. It means whatever the resources it is using, there are so much restrictions are there and limitations are there. You should use only this much consumption, you should use only this much battery life, you should use only this much data, you should use only this much bandwidth, like that. So much restrictions are there. Okay, so these devices may communicate very infrequently. It means very rarely they will communicate with other device, and very rarely they will send the data to other device, and if they send the data, very rarely also that data will be very very less amount of data, very few bytes may be present there. Okay, so and also they will be having a limited security, they will be not secured completely, and management is also very limited. That is, network management or device management is also very very limited. See, these all are constraints or limitations. So here, because of that only, by observing this type of words only, easily you can say that, sir, definitely we should use which model? IP adaptation model. Because here everything is constrained here. There is no any freedom for you. So all constraint, all aspects are in some restrictions or some limitations. So definitely you should use IP adaptation model for such type of devices. Okay. So then second category is devices with enough power and capacities. There is a so much power is there. That is, a battery power is also sufficient, and it has so much capacities to implement some IP stack as well as a non-IP stack. There is some flexibility is there comparative to previous category, right? So definitely here you can use either adoption or else you can use adaptation. When you can use adoption again here, so if you are using a IP stack, if you are using a IP stack, it means in your device, in your network, all devices are IP devices. And if these devices are able to directly communicate with the application servers, then you can use adoption. Otherwise means what? In your network, there are both IP devices are also there, as well as some non-IP devices are also there. Non-IP devices like a set-top box of our television and a cable card, so many other non-IP devices are there. If both of them are there in your network and they are not communicating with servers directly, they are communicating with the servers through these gateways or proxy servers, then you should choose or select which model? that is adaptation model. Okay, so very beautiful concept actually. Okay, last category is devices that are very similar to our PC. See, our PC is able to communicate with all devices without any problem, right? So here, so much flexibility is there. Everything is perfect here. The devices are very much similar to our PC in terms of computing or in terms of power resources, right? So, but they also have some constrained network capabilities. Very less amount of constraints are there. For such type of devices, definitely you should use a full IP stack. If it is a full IP stack, then definitely what model you have to select, that is adoption model. Okay, so based on these all requirements and features or characteristics, we have to select either adoption model or adaptation model. And these are three categories of devices, particular which devices? Constrained devices or constrained nodes. Okay, so now let us go to the next topic, that is constrained networks. See, till now just I was talking about the devices, their battery backup and all those things, right? So now onwards, we are going to discuss about the limitations or restrictions of a network. It means whenever the word network comes into in our mind, so what are the things we will think about? So networking is nothing but connectivity, connecting two things or more than two things, right? So one device is connected with another device through a link. Okay, so that link may be either wireless or it may be wired. Okay, so now we are going to discuss about only about that link which is connecting two devices. It may be bandwidth, it may be frequency, so many speed of that link. These are things we are going to study now. Okay, in earlier days in internet, the network bandwidth capacity was restrained due to some technical limitations. It means that in earlier days, the internet speed was less because of less bandwidth. Okay, so usually these connections in our internet, they were dependent upon some modems which were low speed modems. Okay, so to transfer the data in internet, the connections were dependent upon low speed modems. Okay, so these are limitations I am talking, limitations of our network. Okay, so these low speed connections or low speed modems or connections, they were demonstrated. It means they have shown us IP also can be run over low power, low bandwidth networks. It means that since from earlier days also, we started to use IP, that is internet protocol, even though they have a low bandwidth. Clear? So, but after many years, that is if you consider today's era, okay, nowadays we have high speed infrastructure everywhere, high speed Wi-Fi, high speed modems, high speed routers. Okay, so a high speed bandwidth, we have high speed infrastructure right now. Okay, so however, high speed connections are not usable by some IoT devices. See, in IoT devices, in IoT networks, some devices don't want these high speed connections. They want low speed only. It's okay for them. Okay, so it means that they are not using high speed connections to transfer the data very frequently. The reasons may be implementation of technologies with a low bandwidth, the technologies which require very less bandwidth, and the distance will be also less, and the bandwidth will be also less, and the power will be continuously keep on regulating. Okay, and there may be lack of some limited network services. So these all are limitations. So because of that only, some IoT devices, they don't want to use this high speed connections. They want to use only low speed connections only because of these all reasons. So when this link layer characteristics that we have taken for granted, this link layer characteristics, if they are not present, then that network is called as constrained. Remember, data link layer is there, right, in your protocol stack. It has its some characteristics. Okay, so if some characteristics of those link layer characteristics are not present there, then that network will be constrained. Some limitations will be there, and that constrained network can have a high latency. See here, so since you are putting a conditions and limitations on this network, Definitely there will be a high latency. What do you mean by latency? Latency is nothing but a delay. That is the time taken by the receiver to respond back to you. That is a very high here. The receiver will take too much time to reply you. Okay, so latency will be also high, and high potential of packet loss. It means that it can tolerate the packet loss or data loss. Okay, so these all are about constrained networks or limitations of networks. So these constrained network have some unique characteristics or properties, and they have their own requirements also. But in our typical, original IP networks, they don't have any requirements, or they don't have any this one, that is limitations. Okay, so in our IP networks, we have a high stable and we have a fast links. Okay, but in the constrained networks, we have a low power links, we have a low bandwidth links. Okay, and that link may be either wireless or wired. Are you comparing constrained network with IP network? Okay, IP networks are not constrained networks. IP networks are having high stable and fast links. Links are very much stable and links are very much fast here. But in constrained networks, the links are low power and less stable and low bandwidth and less speed links. And links may be wireless or wired. Okay, so these networks or these links, whatever just now I told you, constrained links, they will operate in between a very few amount of data they want to transfer. That is a very few kbps to few hundreds of kbps, and sometimes they use the topology, which is a star topology or a mesh topology. Sometimes they will use both combined topologies. Okay, so for proper operations, they use very few kbps data. Okay, and they use star topology or mesh topology, or sometimes combined, both of those combination of both of them for proper operations. Then with these constrained networks, okay, so definitely there will be bandwidth will be limited. So if this bandwidth is limited, then it is very common for us, the packet delivery rate will be also very less here. Since bandwidth itself is less, then definitely the rate of delivery will be less. It will be in between low to high percentages. So definitely it will be in terms of less only. Usually it will be keep on oscillating. It means it will be keep on fluctuating because of this less bandwidth. Okay, then also there will be some possibilities of getting some unexpected errors also. And even sometimes we may get loss of connectivity. Suddenly connection may be loss. Okay, so these all are some limitations or require these restrictions because of this limited bandwidth. Okay, so these behaviors or these characteristics are observed both on wireless as well as on wired links. Okay, so because of these all limitations, the packet delivery will be varied. It means there will be a variation or fluctuation in the packet delivery. Okay, so then one very beautiful sentence is here. That is one golden rule is there, what we should follow. That rule is underreact to the failure. Underreact to the failure. Underreact to the failure. It means see. One golden rule whenever we use a constrained network is we should not overreact to the failure. If a communication or something is failed there, don't overreact there. Just underreact. It means it can be recovered. It can be recovered. Don't worry about it, even though there is a failure of communication. Okay? So in constrained networks, don't overreact. Underreact to this failure. Okay? And due to this less bandwidth or limited bandwidth, a constrained network overacts usually. It starts to overact. And then what happens? This overacting will lead us to the network collapse, which makes the existing problem still worse or more worse. Already we have problem because of less bandwidth, the less power and all those things. So that's why we are calling them as a constrained network, right? So if these constrained networks started to overreact to the failures, okay, so then whatever the existing problem is there, it will become worse. So instead of overreacting, just underreact to the failure. Just don't worry about it. Don't bother more about that failure. Okay, because already you have a constrained network. Because of that, as per the resources, accordingly your network will work, right? So low bandwidth, definitely less speed. If you want high speed, then you should go for high bandwidth. Then that network is not called as constrained network. Okay, since your network itself is a constrained network, some failures are very common there. So don't overreact, just underreact to the failures. Okay, then let us go to next topic, that is IP versions. Last topic of this module, sorry, this topic, main topic, because I am discussing about today about need for optimization, right? Which levels, in which all the places we can optimize, that we are discussing. Okay, so first I discussed constrained nodes, then I discussed constrained networks. Now I am going to discuss very beautiful and very interesting topic, that is IP versions. You know, IP is the internet protocol, which is a network layer protocol, right? So you are very much familiar with IPv4 and IPv6, which are version 4 of IP and version 6 of IP, right? So since from last 20 years, one organization is continuously trying to transit IPv4 to IPv6. It means it is trying to shift the entire world from IPv4 to IPv6. It means, sir, why it is trying? That organization is IETF, Internet Engineering Task Force. What is it? It is a leading internet standard body. It is an organization which is trying to make the entire world or people to stop using IPv4, and they want to make us to use IPv6. Why? I think in the previous classes, I clearly told you the limitation of addresses is the main reason here. With IPv4, you cannot address, you cannot identify uniquely each and every device nowadays, because nowadays the number of devices are keep on increasing. In fact, IP addresses, all IP addresses are exhausted. Now, because of that only, we should start to use now IPv6, which will never exhaust, because every sand grain also can be addressed uniquely with IP address. That many number of IP addresses are present in IPv6. Okay, so this body or this organization is trying to transit from IPv4 to IPv6. Okay, the main reason is here I am telling you. So the main driving force is nothing but lack of address space. See, all IP addresses are exhausted now. All IP addresses are completed, finished now. Every device got its IP address. All IP addresses are exhausted now. Now, whatever the new device will come to the network, it may not get the IP address. Okay, for that reason, we have to go to IPv6, because IPv6 has much larger range of addresses, which should not be exhausted for the foreseeable future. Foreseeable future means in future also, these addresses will not be exhausted. Okay, every device will be addressed uniquely with IP. Okay, so both versions of IP, both versions of IP means what? IPv4 and IPv6, they will run over this internet. But still today, most of the traffic in our internet is based on IPv4 only. Okay, so because of that only, we have to shift from IPv4 to IPv6 now onwards. Okay. See, the IoT has a support Definitely for both of these versions, IPv4 and IPv6 presently. Why it is supporting and how it is supporting? You know, tunneling technology we should use, and one more technology or technique, translation we should use. These techniques are helping us a lot, okay? Because nowadays, suppose if you consider two networks, one network may be supporting IPv4, one network may be IPv6 network. Because both of them are existing in today's era. So because of that only, IoT should support both of them. Then how it should support? It will use two techniques here, like tunneling and translation. Okay. So what are these tunneling and translation? So just for your understanding purpose, I show you the diagram. It is not actually in your book. You will understand what is this tunneling and what is this translation. Okay. This is a tunneling. See, here one network is there. This is IPv6 network, and here also destination network is also IPv6 network. But this network is sending the data to this network through one more network, which is IPv4. Purely it is IPv4. It means all devices, all links are supporting IPv4 here. Okay, all devices are addressed with IPv4 IP addresses. Okay, you know IPv4 address, how it looks like. Okay, so it contains some four numbers which are separated by dot, right? So here IPv6 network is there. Whatever the data it is sending, so if you observe that data format, here IPv6 for data is there, actual data, and this data has some header here, which is also IPv6 header. It is telling that this data is in IPv6. Then this data, if you want to send to this, you have to first encapsulate, or it you have to first encapsulate that data inside IPv4 header. It means it is having one envelope. Inside that envelope, you are putting your IPv6 data with IPv6 header, but that wrapper or that envelope is showing that this is carrying IPv4 data. So then this IPv4 network will believe it, and it will allow it to transmit to the end of this network. And this device B, which is a destination, again it receives same data whatever it was sent in the earlier in at the receiver's sorry, sender side. It means that when that message or data will be reached to this device B, at that time before delivering that data, this header, IPv4 header, will be removed and original data will be delivered to the IPv6 network device. Are you understanding? So here this IPv4 network is assuming that I am transmitting the data which is IPv4 data only. But once that data crosses that network, again it will remove that wrapper or envelope and it will become IPv6 data. This is a tunneling. Then what do you mean by translation? Translation is nothing but suppose if you have IPv4 network here and here you have IPv6 network, and if you want to send any data to this, and in between this one you need one a translator here, because this is IPv4 and this is IPv6, right? IPv4 has an address like this, IP addresses looks like this, IPv6 IP addresses looks like this. Okay, so this type of a translations is required whenever you want to send the data to IPv6. So this translator will translate into IPv6 data, and if IPv6 network want to communicate with IPv4 network, again this translator will convert that IPv6 data to IPv4 data, and it will send it to the IPv4 network. Okay, these are two techniques which we can use because of this problem of IPv4 and IPv6. Those are called as tunneling and translation. So many varieties of factors we have to consider for this, whether I should use IPv4, or whether I should use or select IPv6, or whether I should use both of them. Okay, so many factors are there. So what type of factors they are? Those factors are legacy protocol or technology that supports only IPv4. So based on these, you can either select IPv4 or else IPv6 or both of them. So one is what you should think about is whether you want a legacy protocol and whether you want a legacy technology. If you want to use this legacy protocol and legacy technologies, you can choose IPv4 because they support IPv4. But new technologies, whatever they are coming now, new technologies and new protocols, okay, almost they always support both of these IP versions, because nowadays we are using both IPv4 as well as IPv6, right? Some networks or some devices are IPv4, some networks, some devices are IPv6 devices. So new technologies, whatever nowadays we are using, and new protocols, whatever we are using, usually they support both of them. And the following are some of these main factors which are applicable to IPv4 and IPv6 support in IoT solution. So what are the factors we should keep it in our mind whenever there is a question of a selection of IPv4 or IPv6? The first factor is application protocol. Okay, so based on this application protocol, we can decide whether I want to use IPv4 or IPv6. See, this IPv IoT devices which are using Ethernet or Wi-Fi, that can communicate over both of these IPv4 and IPv6. But the application protocol may dictate, or they allow, or they tell us the choice of IP version. The selection of IP version is only dependent upon the implementation. Keep it in your mind, okay? It completely dependent upon your implementation. What type of implementation you want, IPv4 or IPv6, okay? Then the second factor is cellular provider and the technology. You know, some cellular modems are there in IoT, and those cellular modems are dependent upon this generation of cellular technology. Generation of cellular technology means, for your understanding purpose, I have written here 1G, 2G, 3G, 4G, and nowadays 5G also there, right? Depending upon this cellular technology, generation of cellular technology, as well as the data services they provide, the data services they are providing us, based on this also we can decide whether I want to use IPv4 or IPv6. The first three generations here, 1G, 2G, 3G, they are GPRS, Edge, and 3G. They are completely based on IPv4. They are completely based on base protocol is here, IPv4. But 4G and 5G onwards, 4G and 5G are called as 4G/LTE networks. They are mainly dependent upon IPv6. Okay, so here, consequently, IPv6 is used with this generation. It can be tunneled over IPv4. Okay, so on 4G networks, data services can use either IPv4 or IPv6, because now we are using 4Gs only, right? So here, this 4G can use either IPv4 or IPv6. It is supporting both of them as a base protocol. Okay, just remember, 1G, 3G, sorry, 1G, 2G, 3G is completely dependent upon IPv4, and 4G and 5Gs are completely dependent upon both of them. So it means that 4G and 5Gs are supporting both IPv4 as well as IPv6. Clear? Okay. I think in 2 minutes this meeting will end. So I will wind up the class today here. In the next class, I continue with still one or two slides are there. Then I will go to next topic. Okay. Okay, now then meet you, see you tomorrow in the next class. We can leave the meeting now.